Hey, in this video we are going to talk about GeoGuessing and OSINT from a practical point of view. We will solve every OSINT challenge from the UMDCTF 2023, learning during the process the basic toolset and the most common practices to adopt for those kind of challenges. By the way, I'm neither an OSINT expert nor a GeoGuessr master. This was the first time I played those kind of challenges and I had a lot of fun, but that's it. This video is just a summary of my experience and a way to share the knowledge I learned during the process. Having said that, during the UMDCTF 2023, there were two different types of OSINT challenges. The gun missing trio, which involves three different GeoGuessr style challenges of increasing difficulty, and the TCC story, based on a more traditional OSINT scenario. For all those who, like me, have never heard about GeoGuessr, those are challenges where we are dropped somewhere in the world in a street view panorama and we must guess our exact location based only on our surroundings. We can start by taking a look at the first GeoGuessr-like challenge, named Gun Missing One. For this challenge, we are teleported into a park. The first distinctive element of the place that can be noticed is a statue, but right after we can see a very unique palace with a red flag at the top. As we continue to look around, there do not seem to be any other particularly useful elements. Generally speaking, the more unique elements we can find in the surroundings, the easier it becomes to pinpoint the exact location where we are. In this case, the red flag is a good indicator, but the uniqueness of this building allows us to easily pinpoint its location using any search engine that also accepts images. Just with a single search, Google was able to identify that it is the Royal Palace in Oslo. We can search for it on Google Maps and submit the newly discovered position using the map provided by the challenge. The second gun missing challenge is very similar to the first one. We are at the top of a rocky hill and in front of us there are a flag and a weird star. Looking around, we can notice an arid and desert setting, but nothing very interesting other than the position of the sun, which is rising and thus indicates the east. As with the challenge earlier, the star seems to me particular enough that we can easily identify it through a reverse image search. This time we can use Yandex, a Russian search engine that was one of the first, as well as best, engines to support reverse image search. One of the first results points us to Castle Rock in Colorado. Searching it on Google Maps and enabling the 3D globe view, we can search for any suspicious island. During the challenge, I didn't notice that the mesa was right in front of me. However, by using the street view mode and looking around, I immediately identified the plateau with the flag, thus finding the right place. The third gun missing challenge was tough, and I solved it only after the end of the competition. We are dropped in front of a pole with an Asian banner attached to it. Looking around, we can see that we are in front of a turn and in the middle of a country. In the background, there is an Asian-shaped building, but it's difficult to tell what it is. Unlike before, we don't have major elements that allow us to accurately identify our location. We must use the many minimal pieces of information available to us to try to orient ourselves. The three big elements that can help us are the banner, the type of pole that looks very distinctive, and the label with six numbers attached to it. Looking around more closely, we can also notice a couple of markings on the asphalt, which might perhaps come in handy later, the black and yellow curved signs, and the location of the power towers, which pass over the forest and which we can use as a reference. My initial efforts focused on identifying the banner and figuring out what was written on it. After some time spent scanning it with various OCRs, I realized that the banner was mirrored. I adjusted the photo and scanned the sign again, understanding that we are in Yulin country, in Taiwan. This region, however, is huge. How can we narrow down the research? I started investigating the six number plate we noticed on the pole, searching for all the different poles used in Taiwan. I discovered they use a standardized layout for utility poles. They are striped black and yellow, and each of them has a blue sign that can be used as a coordinate. The logic behind those signs is pretty cool. The first letter of the sign indicates a specific square region in Taiwan. The following four numbers, divided into two pairs, instead indicate the X and Y coordinate in percentage value. With this method, it's possible to pinpoint a specific pole with an error of about 10 meters. There is also a Wikipedia page reserved entirely for the topic, with some scripts for performing the conversion. Give it a look in case you need it. Unfortunately, this blue sign is not on the light pole we were given as a reference, and the sign on the pole in front of us was not readable enough. From this moment, the treasure hunt began. I started looking in every major city in Yulin for poles that had the same 6-number plate, trying to understand the numbering flow of the poles. In the center of the region, in Hiwei, we found a pole starting with 295. In the suburb of Dunan, instead, we found one that begins with 312. Near Gukeng, we found 392. We roughly identified the area. We need to look for our location in the eastern area of Yulin. On Route 157 and in the Dapi surroundings, we found some poles with the number 330. We are getting closer. From this point forward, I began to focus on the other secondary element that can help us identify our location. Pylons, wooded area, road design, and your like and subscription to my channel. Obviously, the last two things are a joke, but it would be appreciated so much, so thanks in advance. Continuing the research, I suddenly end up on the 158, a road very similar to the one to be identified, whose poles are numbered starting with 310. I started following the road. I saw some familiar curve sign. Then I got lost. Then I found a new promising path. Then I got lost again, until finally I saw the light. A long straight stretch through the countryside. In the end, a yellow button pole. The number is 320. We are close. I advance a few meters, going after the curve. Here we are. That's our pole. We can drop our Pikachu placeholder on the southern 158 and obtain our third and last flag for the GeoGuessr-like challenges. The TCC storyline is much more in line with traditional OSINT research. The first challenge tells us about a specific website and a Discord server that used to be linked inside, and now is no longer there. Looking at the site, there is no reference to the mentioned Discord. However, we can look for some older site versions in some public caches or historical archives. The three I always try are Google Cache, which in this case has a too recent version of the site, Webpage Archive, which again has a too recent version, and Wayback Machine, which in this case has cached the version with Discord and allow us to get the server link through the website footer. Once access the server, we get the first flag. The second challenge refers to a secret page on the TCC website. Looking at the page, we can see we are asked 4 different questions to proceed. The first question is about the position of the TCC team in their latest disputed CTF. We can easily get this information by looking for the team on CTF time. The second question is about the company whose Piku is working for. Since we have Piku's email, thanks for the contact page, we can perform a quoted search of his email and look at the result that appeared to us. One of the various results is his CV. We can download it or open it with Google Cache, discovering that Piku works for Leidos. The third question is about Bree's favorite CTF category. The information is easily guessable both from the TCC members page, where Bree used hashtag MissGang to describe itself, as well from the Discord channel, where Bree says that he would have participated in a CTF if there had been MISC challenges. The fourth and last question is about a gift that Bloop is going to buy. The solution to this question is not immediate. On the TCC Discord server, there is a subthread named Gift, where Bloop asked his teammates for some ideas. The thread never mentioned exactly what the gift is, but it ends with Bloop saying he will buy some storage thing. During the discussion, however, some important clues are given. First, the name of the bride is Bulberina. Second, Piku and Bloop suggest there is a public list from which anyone can choose a gift. Before the end of the CTF, I was not aware of this, but I later discovered that there are public wedding lists on Amazon called Amazon Registries that anyone can access. We can go to this page and search for Bulberina. Only one list appears. We can search and submit all the storage stuff brands, eventually discovering that the response for the fourth question is the Shazo brand. TCC3 is all about diff comparing the members page with the contacts one. We must find some contact information for one of the members that are out of office. From the contacts page, we can get every TCC member's email except the macho one. We can see, however, that all of them follow the same pattern, so we can easily guess that the macho email is macho.umdctf2023@gmail.com. Sending an email to every address, we receive an out-of-office response from Macho, which contains, amongst the various things, also its number. We can investigate the information related to the phone number as well as other information using the tools provided inside the OSINT framework. In this case, however, we can simply obtain the resulting TCC-free flag by calling the match host telephone number.
UMDCTF left curly bracket 10U_H4B3_13.
For the last challenge, we must find the Twitter profile of match host and discover the secret information he's disclosing. We can try to see if some free OSINT services online can identify his profile using his email. But unfortunately, the only one that worked didn't give us the actual URL. Looking at the PQ followers and following profiles, nothing show up. Searching for the macho keyword on Twitter, well, you would better not see the result. At this point, we can try the Twitter advanced search. This kind of search allows us to specify keywords we want to include or exclude, search for specific words or sentences, specify a time window, and much more. Basically, it is just an interpretation of Google Docs inside Twitter. I started searching for the macho signature he always wrote, but without finding anything useful. I also checked for some possible sentences inspired by the Discord messages that he could have written, but also in this case nothing worked. After a lot of trial and error, useless research and lots of macho man tweets, I finally found the Matchhawk profile simply searching for his name and surname. Even now, I don't understand how it is possible that the search engine indexed his profile without it containing any of the true words. Scrolling through the tweets, however, we can notice a pastebin link that once opened delivered us the final flag for the TCC storyline. As I said at the beginning of the video, this was intended to be a very introductory video to the category of challenge and nothing more. I had a lot of fun solving some of the challenges and I hope the same can apply to you. Have you ever played this category of CTF? Do you have any other recommendations for GeoGuessr CTFs? Let me know it in the comment section below. Thanks to everyone who stayed with me up to here. I hope you enjoyed the video and that you find it helpful. If so, please consider leaving me a like and subscribe to the channel so that we can meet again in the coming videos. Having said that, see you next time. Ciao.